Good morning, and welcome to Hively Avenue Mennonite Church on this kind of blustery Sunday morning. It's also the first Sunday in Lent. I want to welcome all of you, and especially visitors. We like to welcome special visitors. If you have come with somebody and they want to introduce you, this would be the time. I will just say that we have a special visitor with us, Quinn Brenneke. I hope I said that right, Brenneke. He's a pastor at Prairie Street Mennonite Church and has been there for 2 years. So we're looking forward to him sharing what God has laid on his heart for this morning. Anybody else? Over there.
Greg Sudum. Woo. This is Luis from Mozambique and Christian from Chad. They are IVEPers. So this is just a bit of a preview of what we're going to have on Wednesday when we have 16 IVEPers and 3 MCC staff. So I guess I'm putting in a little bit of plug for the spiritual emphasis night on Wednesday night at 5:30 with the meal.
Thank you. Welcome. And we like to have our announcements done early in the worship service. Look at your bulletins and see what's in it. I will call on Jamie to say something about time and talents, right?
Hi, Jamie Pitts from Gift Discernment Committee. The time and talent sheets were distributed last week. We only got 10 back, so we really need to be able to do our work together as the church. We need to hear from you about what you are interested in doing, what you might consider with some pressure from us doing. So please fill these out. Carol has been giving them out, so hopefully you received one. If you are looking at this thing, and maybe you filled it out before, maybe it's the first time, and you're, what are these roles? Come talk to us. So our names are on here. We'd love to help you if this seems intimidating to find a place for you to be able to plug into Hively and collaborate with us. So thanks.
Thank you, Jamie. And that's so important that we all feel we're working together and doing our part in making our church work. I'd like to point out the spiritual emphasis for this week. You'll find that in your bulletin. And that will be March the 9th at 5:30 p.m. I'll let you read what that's all about, but you're all welcome to come to this meal and a program afterwards. Any other? Yes.
What I'd like to emphasize is kind of like Jamie, we've got a few responses here, but it would help us to know how to plan both for the meal and the table setup, since much of this will be interactions around the table. So that would be very helpful for us to know. And I think my contact information is in there.
I wonder if people are concerned about safety with masks on. You can't eat with your masks on, that's obvious. So I'm sure you've thought about that.
Well,
how to keep safe. Like having people more scattered or, yeah. Okay, I'll leave that up to you then. So let's move on to our worship this morning. Like I said, today is the beginning of the season of Lent. Lent is a time to repent, to turn from our ways and recommit ourselves to the ways of God, as revealed in Jesus. The verse from Isaiah 55, verse 8, tells us and reminds us that our thoughts, I'm sorry, my thoughts are not your thoughts, says the Lord, nor are your ways my ways. Throughout the 6 weeks of Lent, we will be asking the question, what now? And seeking God's way. Today we will be looking at what is keeping us bound. You might have wondered about the table in front of us, and that will be revealed a little later on, but that's in keeping with the theme, what is keeping us bound? What would it take for us to let go? Personally, in preparing for today, my thoughts are those in keeping with lament. All the losses that we have experienced this last year through medical crisis and unsettling pandemic, and now the endless shattering daily news of what's happening in Ukraine. Sometimes other people can use words that say more than I can possibly say. So I want to share a few words or a few paragraphs from this book called Prayers of Honoring. This is a prayer for honoring sorrow. Thank you for this day of suffering. I am so sad about some things that have happened. It is unnerving that I cannot unmake them. Show me a place where I'm free to express my mourning for so long as it takes. Put me in circles of others enduring ceaseless pain. And help us to shelter one another in care and flowing witness. Grant mercy for my heartache as I travel this mysterious landscape. Help me navigate with purpose. Soften my face, so I may see that I'm still here underneath these big feelings. Unravel my worries about whether it might always be this way. Keep me present to my healing process. Help me engage my grief with consciousness. And help me articulate the nature of my grievances and offer them up to the heavens, not to hurry up and get over them, but to ask for small spaces of respite between the waves. Teach me to be the one to release the torment of generations behind me, and the one who wails for all of our losses. Open my spirit for the great exchange between you and me over this. And let's join together in our call to worship. I will read the light, ask you to read the bold. Together we seek the way of God. We crave the safety of God's shelter.
The security of the Lord.
God offers the care of angels. God's generous to all who call on God's holy name. So come, let us seek God's way of generosity. I'll call on Ed Kaufman and the music group for number 11, Mountain of God.
Seated, turn to number 151. We are going to start instituting a song of the month, and this is our song for this month, Lamb of God. The group will sing it together this time, and later on in the service we'll sing it together as a congregation. So we'd like to introduce it to you at this time.
Let's pray together. And so we come, loving God, with all our longings and fears, and an honesty and open hearts and minds. We want to learn more about you and your ways. Teach us to hear your voice. Thank you for being here with us this morning, here in your house, and to worship you in song, word, and deed. With gratitude for Jesus, in whose name we pray, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Time for lighting the peace candle. And I would like to read a prayer from Corrimila community. Some of you might know Corrimila. God who sees the weakness in acts of naked aggression. Oh, by the way, this is a prayer for peace for the people in Ukraine. I'll start again. God who sees the weakness in acts of naked aggression. God who feels the fear in moments of acute helplessness. Cure the warring madness and shield all who fall in harm's way. Reach the person from the mind that thinks strength is shown in a bullying force. And may an equal strength and solidarity give resolve to those whose aim it is to protect and respect. Not just the ones we call our own, but all with whom we share a better, more peaceful world. Amen. Please join me in our peace, lighting the peace candle that we do every Sunday morning. And we repeat a prayer together. God of peace,
Christ of peace, Spirit of peace, you are calling
us to be peacemakers. Today we light this candle as a reminder of our calling. And now, children, this is your time. You want to come up, children, and hear a story? And our pastor, Jake, will tell you a story.
Good morning, little friends. How is everyone today? Good. So good to see you all this morning. And this morning, you'll get to see yourselves a little bit. Can you see yourselves in this little mirror? Yeah? Aren't those some good-looking faces in there? Yeah. This is what we get to enjoy. Well, I brought this today. I borrowed it from some friends of ours who use this at their house with their little girls when they're maybe feeling upset, or even when they're feeling happy, or they have different emotions. Maybe you've heard of emotions. They can use this because there's some different faces that you can pull out and look at to help reflect what emotion you're feeling right now. So,
For instance, let's see here. Let me see if you all can make some good faces for me. How about, can you give me your best smiley face, like this one? I know it's harder with masks on. Yeah, let's see them. Adults, you can do this too. Smiley face, those are some good smiles. All right, how about, ooh, this one is surprised. You ever get surprised? Whoa, Cadence, that was a good one. Yeah, we've got some good surprise faces. Let me see here. Ooh, green here is fear or scared.
Scary?
Yeah, scary. You ever feel scared at all? No. Wynn's like, nope, never been scared. How about, ooh, I don't know if you've ever felt this way. You ever feel a little angry? Yeah, let's see those angry faces. And then how about this last one? Do you ever feel, let's see if we can get it out. Here we go. How about, yeah, you ever feel a little bit this way? A little sad? Yeah, with tears? Yeah. Well, I think most of us usually feel this whole range of emotions. Maybe not if every day, at least every week we kind of go through these. Now, how about, sometimes in church we talk about this guy, Jesus. Do you think Jesus, because we talk about Jesus being like kind of God with us. Do you think Jesus felt all these emotions too? What do you think, Nathaniela?
He looks happy.
He looks happy?
Kind of sad when Lazarus died.
Oh, wow. You're already jumping ahead. Nathaniela said he's happy, but he kind of looks sad when Lazarus died. Well, that was the whole story, so you've already got it there. Yeah, you're right. That Jesus, we see in the Gospels that talk about Jesus' story, we hear about him being like happy. We hear about him being surprised by things. He marveled at people who believed in him, who you wouldn't think would believe in him. Mm-hmm. He felt all of these emotions, and he even, like Nathaniela pointed out, he even felt sadness, real deep sadness. Because she mentioned this story about Lazarus. Now, Lazarus was somebody who was Jesus's friend. And they told Jesus, he was away somewhere, and they told Jesus, Jesus, your friend is sick. Please come and help him, because they knew Jesus had these special powers that sometimes he could heal people and help them. So they said, Jesus, your friend is sick. And Jesus told them up front, he said, don't worry, this sickness isn't going to end in death. So it seemed like Jesus knew what the end of the story was going to be. But you know what? Even when Jesus knew that, and when he saw his friends crying, and when he heard about his friend having died, even though he kind of knew what the end of the story would be, guess how Jesus still felt?
Sad.
He still felt really sad. Yeah. And it said, this is the shortest verse in the whole Bible. It's only two words long. It says, Jesus wept. Now, weeping isn't just like, little tiny tears. It's like you're wailing and crying. Maybe when you like hurt your knee or something. I mean, real deep crying. It says Jesus wept, even though he knew his friend might come back, even from the dead. So that means sadness must be pretty important emotion for us to feel sometimes, right? Is it okay for us to feel sadness sometimes then, you think? Yeah. I mean, maybe not if it's little things like you have to eat broccoli or things like that. I know we don't like that, but we don't have to cry about it, right? But you love broccoli? Well, good. You're already on the good path. But there are times when it is really okay. In fact, it's one of the best things that we can do is to feel really sad when we see sadness in our friends and in our others. And even if we know that someday God's going to make everything right again, it's okay in that moment to feel that deep sadness and to cry with others and to weep ourselves. So that's the story that we're going to hear today from Pastor Quinn. And I want you guys to remember that it is okay to feel all these emotions. In fact, it's really healthy to feel all these emotions at different times, all right? And we're so thankful that you guys are here with us. So let's pray, and you can go back to the table or your seats, wherever you want to go. God, we thank you that you You know us better than anyone else. You know our deepest emotions. Even when we hide them from you, Lord, you know what we're feeling. So help us, God, to feel okay to be happy when there's things to be happy about, or scared when it feels scary, or sad when something sad happens. Help us to know that you too have felt those emotions, that you feel them for us and with us. Thank you for each child here today. They are such a blessing and a treasure for our congregation, and I pray that they would know that, God. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Jake. Okay. Let's turn to our responsive reading. And I should add, releasing. Reading and releasing. Please join me. Your ways, O God, are higher than our ways. We seek God's way. I'll ask the ushers to come forward at this time and distribute ribbons to everybody. You are welcome to pick up a ribbon. Just hold it in your hands when you get it. If you don't want one, you don't need to take it. If there's some left over, we can just put them in another, maybe in the office or something. These are ribbons you can take home with you afterwards if you want. If you're comfortable just holding the ribbon in your hands, and if you're comfortable, close your eyes without opening the knot. Ask yourself, what is it that is keeping me bound? Is it fear? Is it anger? What is keeping you knotted up? What is keeping you from freedom? What is it you would be? What is it that you would like to let go of? What is it that you would like to let go of? With this in mind, with this longing to let go of whatever it is, and when you are ready, slowly open the knot. And you can hold it up if that helps. Together, Lord, move us from our ways of clinging to security to your ways of generous living. Jesus offers new life and freedom to all who call on the Lord. As a response, let's sing, "The Lord is my light," number 437. Please join me in the Lenten prayer of confession as written in your bulletins. Holy One, we seek you while you may be found. Have mercy on us, O God, for our thoughts are not your thoughts. And our ways are not your ways. As we walk with Christ on the Lenten journey, let us see your way more clearly and follow your way more faithfully.
Thank you.
hear these words of assurance from Psalm 91, verses 1 and 2. You who live in the shelter of the Most High, who abide in the shadow of the Almighty, will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God, in whom I trust. Sermon text for this morning is John 11, 1 to 16. I will read the scripture in English, and Beth will read it in Spanish. And after that, I'll call Quinn to come forward. Okay. Oops. John 11, verse 1. Now, a certain man was ill. Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Martha was the one who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair. Her brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent a message to Jesus. Lord, he whom you love is ill. But when Jesus heard it, he said, this illness does not lead to death. Rather, it is for God's glory, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Accordingly, though Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, after having heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, let us go to Judea again. The disciples said to him, Rabbi, the Jews were just now trying to stone you, and are you going there again? Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours of daylight? Those who walk during the day do not stumble because they see the light of the world. But those who walk at night stumble because the light is not in them. After saying this, he told them, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to awaken him. The disciples said to him, Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will be all right. Jesus, however, had been speaking about his death. But they thought that he was referring merely to sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him. Thomas, who is called the twin, said to the fellow disciples, let us also go, that we may die with him. The word of the Lord.
Estoy leyendo Juan, capítulo 11, versos 1 a 16. Había un hombre enfermo llamado Lázaro, que era en Betania, el pueblo de María y Marta, sus hermanas. María era la misma que ungió con perfume al Señor y le secó los pies con sus cabellos. Las dos hermanas mandaron a decirle a Jesús, Señor, tu amigo querido está enfermo. Cuando Jesús oyó esto, dijo, esta enfermedad no terminará en muerte, sino que es para la gloria de Dios, para que por ella el Hijo de Dios sea glorificado. Jesús amaba a Marta, a su hermana y a Lázaro. A pesar de eso, cuando oyó que Lázaro estaba enfermo, Se quedó dos días más donde se encontraba. Después dijo a sus discípulos, volvamos a Judea. Rabí, objetaron ellos, hace muy pocos los judíos intentaron apedrearte y todavía quieres volver allá. ¿Acaso el día no tiene 12 horas? Respondió Jesús. El que anda de día no tropieza porque tiene la luz de este mundo. Pero el que anda de noche sí tropieza porque no tiene luz. Dicho esto, añadió, nuestro amigo Lázaro duerme, pero voy a despertarlo. Señor, respondieron sus discípulos, si duerme, es que va a recuperarse. Jesús les hablaba de la muerte de Lázaro, pero sus discípulos pensaron que se refería al sueño natural. Por eso les dijo claramente, Lázaro ha muerto. Y por causa de ustedes me alegro de no haber estado allí, para que crean, pero vamos a verlo. Entonces Tomás dijo a los otros discípulos, vayamos también nosotros para morir con él. La palabra del Señor, gracias a Dios.
God bless you, Quinn, as you speak to us. Just pick up my stuff.
Thank you, Margaret and Beth and Jake and Nataniela for telling us our story this morning. And good morning. My name is Quinn. I'm a pastor at Prairie Street Mennonite Church, and I bring you greetings from Prairie Street just down the road. And I am happy to be here with you all today. In this text that we heard this morning, we meet a person for the first time in the Gospel of John, and this person is Thomas. We hear him speak for the first time, we get to know him, and Thomas, in this text, hears Jesus say, let's go to Judea. Lazarus is dead. Now, we can only guess what Thomas knew at this point. What Thomas likely knew is that the Jewish opposition in Jerusalem was ready to stone Jesus. They wanted Jesus dead. And this Lazarus was Jesus' friend, and Lazarus lived in a town not too far away from Jerusalem. And here Jesus says, let's go over there. Maybe Thomas didn't hear the same message that Jesus heard from Mary and Martha, that Lazarus was sick. But we hear Thomas understanding that Lazarus is dead from Jesus. I think Thomas knew where this was going because the only thing we hear him say is, let's go so we can die with Jesus. Thomas knew where this story was going. And you and I know where the story is going because we tell the story over and over again. Jesus is going to die. And before that happens, Thomas says, let's go. We'll die with you. If they're going to stone you, then they can stone us too. We're in this together. Thomas knew where following Jesus would lead. And I think Thomas probably knew exactly why it would lead to this place. I think Thomas knew what the Pharisees were thinking. The Pharisees were taking care of making sure that God's people in Jerusalem and all the surrounding areas were safe. They were worried about the threatening Roman Empire far away that always had their eyes on God's people. In fact, they were always watching. They were always present. In fact, Jesus healed the son of one of these Roman officials. They were always present around the people. And in fact, if we continue reading in verse 47, the Pharisees get together and they say this: "What are we going to do? This Jesus is doing many miraculous signs. If we let him go on like this, everyone's going to believe in him. And then the Romans will come and take away both our temple and our people." Surely the Pharisees, Thomas, Jesus, they knew that at any given moment the Romans could come and destroy it all. And so these Pharisees were trying to protect their own people. Jesus, his family, God's people, they were trying to protect them so that they wouldn't end up in the limelight of Rome. And they were using the tools that they had. The Pharisees were in charge of maintaining the law, this tradition, this agreement that God's people have with God, that God would bless these people to show the world who God is, and that they would live in a certain way. And this was what the Pharisees were in charge of maintaining. And they used this, their only tool, to try to control Jesus so that they wouldn't be in the spotlight of Rome. They tried to use the law to keep Jesus from building a movement, because they knew, and Thomas knew, and Jesus knew, that living in this kind of way, of building this kind of movement, would lead to death. Death is something that we have become familiar with. At this point, in what has become a 2-year-long pandemic, we've seen the lives of nearly 6 million people in the world lost. And at this very moment, at the end of the lives of these 6 million people, we see yet again the face of death as we sit on the brink of war. I was reading yesterday, maybe some of you read this too, that there are Mennonites in the south part of Ukraine, Mennonite churches, and in this particular area where these churches are located is currently surrounded by Russian occupation and soldiers. So one of the pastors from one of these Mennonite churches, Pastor Roman, reported that these churches are working together to create soup kitchens. Supplies are low. Food can't come in because of the war. So these Mennonite churches are organizing soup kitchens and bomb shelters. And Pastor Roman has hope that in the case that they would need to use these bomb shelters, these Christians would share the shelter with non-Christians where they can share the good news of life. And then in another city in Ukraine, Maxim and Anya Olifrovsky, they run a youth program, and they work with MCC to do this. They have begun distributing food. In their area, supplies are also low. Their church began meeting online during the pandemic, And now, with half of them seeking refuge 700 miles away in the western part of the country, they are continuing to meet online for prayer and encouragement. I noticed in your bulletin that even here at Hively, there's a call for collecting funds to send to Mennonite Central Committee, which will send needed supplies to Ukraine. Sisters and brothers, we are looking at the face of death. And this isn't easy for us to deal with. We're not used to seeing death so close. It makes us uncomfortable. Death is separation, permanent separation, isolation, loneliness. The things that we are most afraid of are made real in death. And here we are looking at this, the thing we fear the most, in its face. And I wish I could tell you, sisters and brothers, that following the way of Jesus would take us away from the face of death. I wish I could stand here and tell you that that is the good news that we hear in our text today. But it's not. I wish I could tell you that following the way of Jesus would lead us to some kind of utopia. In fact, all of us, I'm Mennonite too, I get this. We have this idea that if we follow Jesus, we'll create this perfect community. But I'm so sorry to tell you that that's not what the text says today. Following Jesus won't lead us to a utopia. Following Jesus will lead us to the face of death. And in this season of Lent, we are made aware as we follow the story of Jesus to his death over these coming weeks that we too will face death, that we too are mortal. We're limited, we're human. Sisters and brothers, you will die. I will die. The threat of Roman violence outlined this story, pitted God's people against each other. We have Jerusalem and Judea and the Pharisees and other religious leaders who maintain the traditions of God's people. They are ultimately concerned with making sure that God's people would survive into the future. They would maintain their traditions so that this tradition could continue on, so that God's blessing would be made known to this world. And they were also concerned that their people would survive the Roman Empire. And then further north of there, the people living in Galilee were struggling themselves to survive under the reality of taxation from an empire that they didn't choose for themselves. The fact that their own people and Jerusalem would enforce them to maintain rituals that were just seeming impossible to do given their context. And if we follow the story the way we should understand it, if the way that this world would show us how this story would go, if we know that this is a world that brings us to death, then what we would expect to happen in this story is that God's people would have imploded in this pressure. They would have found themselves in the face of death, and God's people would have died. They would have been eliminated given these circumstances. But then God did something. Now, I think God had a few options. Seeing that God's people were facing their end in impossible circumstances, the way this world would take them would be to death, but God did something. And perhaps God could have chosen to show up in Rome, say, easy, easy, calm down. You don't need to take over. You don't need to conquer. God could have showed up in Rome and changed things from there, changed the trajectory of history, but God didn't do that. Perhaps God could have showed up in Jerusalem among the leaders of God's people, the ones charged with maintaining their traditions. God could have showed up and provided an alternative, new leadership for God's people. God could have done that, but that's not what God chose to do. God chose to come to this world, to put on a body like ours in Galilee. God chose to be a Galilean, the one struggling to survive under taxation, under religious demands. God showed up in that place among the people who cannot force death on anyone else, but whose only option is to endure death when it comes to them. I imagine that some of us here today feel like Galileans. Perhaps when we read the news, perhaps when we get news of a medical diagnosis, perhaps when anything in our lives is out of control, when we are facing death in its face, when we can't control the forces that might end it all. But from our very ranks, those of us who understand ourselves to be like those of the Galileans, among us, Thomas, a Galilean, speaks up. And he says a word that I believe that Thomas learned from Jesus, who brought to him from God. The God of the universe came here to die with us. And Thomas looks at Jesus and says, "I'm going to die with you too." Thomas learned from the God who came to him as Jesus that God chooses to die with us when we face death. And he said those very words back to him, "I'll die with you too." So when God says this to us, and when Thomas says it, and we all together die at the same time, this thing of death is no longer about separation, it's solidarity. Death will not separate us from God, because God comes to us even in our death. Sisters and brothers, our God, the maker of all of the universe, is dying in Ukraine with the ones who have chosen to die with God. And that doesn't mean that God has disappeared from the face of this earth. When we hear of war and rumors of war, we can trust that God is not absent. When we hear of death, we can trust that God is not far away. When we ourselves feel separated, we can trust that we are not alone. Because the God of all of creation is moving closer to us, even unto death. Amen.
Let's stand together, number what? 764. 764. We'll sing verses 1, 3, and 5. 1, 3, and 5.
Welcome you now to our time of sharing joys and concerns and also responses to the incredibly challenging and I think impactful